Hi everybody, this is a short talk about the MattoCFS computer forensic file system. MattoCFS is a user-space file system that runs on top of the Linux platform and that is geared towards the specific needs for a computer forensic framework with respect to data storage and access and with respect to message bus facilities. In the first part of this presentation, I will have a look at four important ancestors of the MattoCFS forensic file system. The Open Computer Forensic Architecture had a core component named the Anycast. This was basically what in today's world would be called a message broker or a message bus. CarveFS introduced the concept of carve path designations as a way to use pseudo file paths to implement a feature known as inline carving or zero storage carving, where you could extract files from a disk image without actually copying them out. Then, the sealed digital evidence back concept and MinerFS introduced system integrity properties and facilities that I will show are important with respect to the threat of anti-forensics. Let's start off by looking at the Okva Anycast. The Anycast was a message bus solution, kind of like RabbitMQ, but geared solely towards the worker concept. It was part of a computer forensic framework named the Open Computer Forensic Architecture, or OCFA for short. It used the concept of persistent priority queues that for all intent and purposes were infinite in size, a property that we later found out had some drawbacks. Conceptually, the Anycast solution looked a bit like this image here. Module instance processes would put jobs into a priority queue. A module instance in its role as worker would be a consumer of entities from the priority queues. Each job would end up with one of the instances, effectively defining the load between different instances of the same module, potentially running on different servers. In order to understand the Anycast place and shortcomings in a computer forensic framework, we must discuss the concept of the computer forensic tool chain. In this image, we see an example of a tool chain. You must realize that within a computer forensic framework, multiple of these tool chains will be active at the same time. In this example, we have an NTFS file system image in which an self-extracting executable zip file exists. If we follow the tool chain, we see that there is a file system dissector that will extract an executable. This executable as entity, data entity, will travel the toolchain, will have its file type checked, it will be discovered that it's an executable file, the executable file metadata will be extracted. From this metadata we will be able to conclude that it's actually a zip file, the hash will be checked to make sure we don't unzip the same file twice within the framework, and then unzip will take place and an ISO will be extracted. This is just one example of a toolchain where you must realize that the same data entity, the EXE, will be accessed by each of the different tools in the toolchain. So, what issues were there with the Anycast? The problem lies in the very nature of the computer forensic process. In this process, multiple tools in a toolchain are used consecutively on a single piece of data. The infinite size queue, however, combined with lack of throttling in the OCFA framework, resulted in the fact that much data would long have been moved out of the operating system page cache at the moment the next tool would access the data. This would result in many page cache misses and thus many spurious reads from the actual hard disk. Given the I/O intensive nature of computer forensic process, spurious reads can be quite a performance issue for the overall system. Page cache misses as induced by Anycast design are one source of such spurious reads, but in OCFA there were more design issues also leading to even more spurious reads, either by aggravating the page cache miss problem or for other reasons. OCFA used early hashing of all data partially resulting from its primary storage model that was based on content addressed storage, or CAS. This added extra time between the first read and the last read, thus resulting in increased page cache issues. Two other spurious read issues resulted from lack of locality of database design and server-side data entry. Now, before we can look at the MetaConfess and its predecessors file systems, we need to first look at the concept of user space file systems. In Linux and BSD, Fuse allows us to write a file system as a user space process. As you can see in this picture, a Fuse-based file system is built on top of libfuse library. That library allows the user space process to register and mount the file system and hook itself to the kernel level Fuse kernel module in such a way that IO operations on the file system entities end up invoking callbacks within the user space process. How does Fuse fit in the generic concept of a forensic file system architecture? Well, basically some way like this. The actual data, that could either be a forensic disk image or a data archive, resides on a normal file system. That file system is not accessed directly by the computer forensic framework, but it's only accessed by a user space file system implementation that abstracts all I/O operations to that file system. The different module instances of the computer forensic framework will access the user space file system and not the actual file system. One important user space file system ancestor of MetaConfess is CarverFS. CarverFS is a user space file system that allows mounting a single computer forensic disk image and allows then to carve files from unallocated space without actually having to copy out the data. CarverFS introduced the concept of carve path designations, like the one you see at the bottom of this slide. These designations are made of primarily of a combination of offset and size that together describe where in the mounted entity the actual data resides. In order to understand CarverFS, we need to look at the carve path designations. Carve path designations are a simple construct to designate potentially fragmented entities within a parent entity. The most simple carve path consists of an offset, a size and a suitable file extension. If an entity is fragmented, the underscore is used to compose an entity of its fragments. Many file systems support the concept of sparse regions. The last example shows a fragmented file with a sparse section. A carve path produced by one tool might end up as the base for the next tool. As such, carve path designation might be nested. A carve path without an extension is basically a subdirectory in the file system. CarverFS will flatten any second level carve path into a first level carve path by means of a symbolic link to the first level carve path entity. While CarverFS was a big step forward for carving out files, in the light of usage within a computer forensic framework, there were a number of issues. CarverFS was designed to mount a single disk image. In a large case, hundreds of disk images will be entered. In the case of OCFA, this meant that hundreds of disk images would have to be mounted as user space file systems simultaneously, resulting in massive use of system resources that turned out to be prohibitive. Another issue was that for adding data in any other way, cache storage was still needed. A hack was used to use CarverFS with OCFA that basically had modules bypass the CarverFS altogether in order to create one single big archive file. The integration of CarverFS into OCFA never became fully optimal because cache storage remained such an integral part of its core design. 10 years ago, Schatz and Clark defined the concept of sealed digital evidence bags. While their paper was not about computer forensic architectures but about storage formats, they did identify two very important concepts. They identified the need for immutability of data, and also they have identified the need for trusted provenance logs, both concepts that were very important in the eventual design of MetaConfess. Modern insight with respect to system integrity forces us to look at the use of shared mutable state within the computer forensic frameworks. Basically, a forensic framework weaves together a number of tools into a suitable toolchain for different types of data. Each module in such a framework accessing shared mutable data has the theoretic ability to change the shared mutable data. As none of the modules is expected to be malicious, the historic approach to shared mutable data, also used in OCFA, was that this would not be a serious issue. Enter anti-forensics. Tools used in the toolchain, just like programs such as your web browser and PDF reader, do have vulnerabilities. Remember that the suspect controls what data resides on his disk. There could be exploits targeting specific tools or libraries in the toolchain, and these exploits could be used to target shared mutable data in our framework, either corrupting the data or possibly even rendering the whole system useless. With respect to system integrity, experience with Okva has shown some modules can just crash benignly if exposed to certain wrong identified data files. Given that a random crash can have undefined behavior, there remains a serious risk that even non-anti-forensic crashes might corrupt the system through shared mutable data. The fourth and last ancestor of the MatokFS forensic file system is MinorFS. MinorFS is a least authority file system that is based on the use of sparse capabilities. Basically, a sparse capability is an unguessable designation. Conceptually, the fairy tale figure Rumpelstiltskin can be seen as a good example of how a capability works. Basically, it's an unguessable name that gives you some authority over what you are accessing. The link at the bottom of this page shows an example of such a capability as used in MinorFS. MinorFS on itself is not safe. It also requires mandatory access controls, such as AppArmor or SE Linux. Now let's look how the concepts from these four ancestors come together in MatokFS. MatokFS basically has a CarverFS-like read access to the data archive. It has Anycast-inspired integrated local message bus, a MinorFS-like interface to the message bus data and data entry. It uses sealed digital evidence back inspired privilege separation based data freeze to implement immutable data. It implements sealed digital evidence back inspired trusted provenance logging. And it's designed to minimize spurious reads. But let's look at MatokFS on its own. A quick summary of the main features of MatokFS. MatokFS is a user space file system for Linux that has facilities for zero storage carving. It is a hybrid data archive and message bus system geared specifically at the needs of the computer forensic process. One of its primary goals is the minimization of spurious hard disk reads that hinder overall system performance. Next to performance, MatokFS provides multiple anti-forensic facilities, write once access to data and metadata, trusted provenance logs and secure capability-based form of access control for modules communicating with the file system. Okay, so let's start looking at MatokFS now in detail. First, let's look at the system integrity measures that MatokFS introduces. The concept of sealed digital evidence backs introduced us to the idea that data and metadata should be sealed. MatokFS used the fact that it runs under a different user ID than the rest of the system to provide trusted write once immutable data. It also uses this fact to provide trusted provenance log facility. Data and metadata and provenance log are protected from tampering by an exploit against one of the tools in the toolchain. Access to the MatokFS file system with respect to anything that might intervene with this goes through what is called capability-based access control. We implement these in a way we borrowed from the MinorFS least authority file system. Now that we have tackled the anti-forensics and integrity concerns, let's look at what MatokFS does for attenuating our spurious reads problem. First of all, MatokFS has built-in hashing functionality. Whenever data is read from or written to in MatokFS, MatokFS tries if it can use this data to further calculating the hash of any carved-part entities that are this data is part of. Secondly, MatokFS communicates with the Linux kernel regarding archive data being accessed. It informs the kernel of what data will soon want to access again and what data it doesn't. This should allow the kernel to be smarter about page cache handling. In order to allow the message bus and storage system to effectively work together, Motocfs integrates the message bus into the file system. It provides multiple policies for picking messages that are most beneficial to opportunistic hashing or page cache pressure. Finally, Motocfs provides data to the module framework that should allow the framework to properly implement throttling. The first anti-spurious read measure that Motocfs implements is opportunistic hashing. With opportunistic hashing, low-level reads and low-level writes are mapped to high-level active toolchain entities whenever possible, so that the progressive hashing of these entities can occur while a data entity traverses the toolchain. For performance and security concerns, the hashing algorithm used by Motocfs is Blake 2. The result of opportunistic hashing is that when compared to the classic early hashing done in OCFA, the time window between the first read and the last read can be significantly reduced, thus reducing the potential lifetime of a piece of data in the page cache. Shorter average lifespan should result in lower page cache pressure and thus in less page cache misses and spurious reads. A second anti-spurious read facility that Motocfs implements is the use of fadvice or fadvice64 system call. Motocfs keeps track of the archive data used by all active toolchains by means of a reference counting stack. Whenever the reference count for a piece of archive goes from 0 to 1, Motocfs informs the kernel that the data will likely be accessed again soon. Whenever the reference count from a piece of data hits 0, the kernel is notified of this fact that Motocfs won't be accessing it anytime soon. By providing the kernel with this information, Motocfs allows the kernel to be smarter about its page cache handling strategies, thus resulting in less page cache misses. A third anti-spurious read facility that is very important is the use of input throttling. Input throttling is important to prevent the same level of page cache overcommit that we saw in OCFA. While the previous two measures should mitigate this overcommit problem quite a bit, it is much better to use a throttling to make sure that overcommitment stays within a reasonable range that balances the CPU and I/O efficiency concerns. Motocfs itself does not implement throttling. It merely provides the forensic framework on top of it with information that should allow it to implement throttling. Motocfs provides information on the amount of data that the kernel is told is hot, data that will soon be accessed. And it provides data on the amount of jobs in module queues. Using that data, together with info from the kernel, the future framework should be able to implement a solid throttling policy. For the fourth, last and obviously most intrusive anti-spurious read measure, message bus integration, we need to look at tool chain level information. In Carvefs or even in OCFA Anycast, there was no notion of a tool chain. Conceptually, the message bus can know about the tool chain, while the archive on its own cannot. If, however, we look at the previous anti-spurious read facilities, we identify that both fadvice facility and the opportunistic hashing facility need to reside in the archive implementation, yet require and keep information that is at its very core has toolchain lifetime as a requirement for its usability. What it eventually boils down to is that due to these lifetime concerns, the dependencies between the message bus and the data archive are simply too strong to justify not integrating the message bus into the file system. Doing so also allows for different job picking policies. To allow for these different job policies, Motocfs in its messaging bus has moved from priority queues to simple sortable sets. As an added bonus of this integration of the message bus into the file system flows the fact that the access control on data entities entry and the provenance logging conveniently fits into a capability-based message bus-oriented API. It is essential to note that Motocfs in itself is not a computer forensic framework. It merely provides foundational services for such a framework. Motocfs as a system needs a symbiotic relationship with other components in a distributed framework. It needs to communicate with a future module framework, what will be the absolute core of the actual framework setup, with future load balancing facilities, and with a distributed storage mashup. There are some things that Modicafes only facilitates in by providing hooks. Modicafes expects the module framework on top of it to implement routing and file type determination functionality. It provides the routing functionality with a possibility to maintain state. Also, the module framework is expected to implement some form of throttling, especially for entering new data into the system, and to a lesser extent, adding new messages into the system. Modicafes provides data about how filled up the page cache should be, about the cat, and about how much data and messages are queued for different modules. Finally, Modicafes provides hooks for creating multi-server setups. These are geared to respecting locality of data concerns and migrating only the most CPU-intensive data to other servers. This rounds up this presentation. Please check out my Modicafes page on GitHub. And if you have any questions about Modicafes or need assistance in making Modicafes work as part of your computer forensic project, feel free to contact me directly. If you have short questions, please ask it in the comment section of this video. For anything longer and anything that is specific to your own personal project, please contact me via email.